So welcome, Matt. Welcome to my little chat forum here about all things Bond. First off, congratulations on what I think is a beautiful, beautiful work. I'm surrounded by Bond vinyl in this room right now, so I was always going to be a bit of a biased fan and reactor to the movie. But I saw it at the preview at the BFI during the Bond weekend a couple of weekends ago, and I just remember my eyes welling up. And it was just it was the choice of cuts. It was the choice of emotion. It wasn't just the John Barry strings or perhaps the Amy Winehouse stuff. It was just, there was a real amount of work and effort that's gone into this. I can see that. So I think I speak for a lot of Bond fans and a lot of soundtrack fans to say a big thank you, because it's kind of been a really beautiful moment in Bond documentary timeline. And I've watched it a few times and I'll be watching it again. So well done. Well done you.
Thank you so much. What a lovely introduction. Yeah, look, it was a real labour of love for us. We're all Bond super fans, everyone who was involved in it, everyone from Eon all the way to the people actually editing it. So yeah, it was a real dream to work on. And it's funny because obviously on every project, you're working in a bit of a bubble. There's only three people in the room or four people in the room in the edit suite. And then you have to kind of unleash this thing. It's a bit like leaving your kids at the school gate. You're like, please be nice to it. Yeah. So it's very, very nice that you enjoyed it. Thank you.
Well, I'm going to get the Bond jukebox jury questions, the sort of smash hits questions that we used to have back in the day. I just want to get these quick fire ones out of the way and then we'll perhaps get into some more depth. What's your best Bond song?
Well, I would say at the moment I'm saying We Have All the Time in the World. But it's so difficult because probably like you, it's a bit like asking you what your favorite film is or what your favorite song in general is. I would give you a different answer each time probably. My kid's favorite is Man with the Golden Gun. So they've got into that. So we've been listening a lot of that. And my first one in the movies was Living Daylight. So, you know, I've got a lot of favorites, to be honest.
Well, with Bond, I mean, there's 25 films and counting. I would say you can have a favorite and a best. Otherwise, the pub conversations will never conclude. Trust me. Best Bond song performance, because that's different from best Bond song, I think.
Oh, God, that's a really good question, actually. Which ones? When I've seen them. OK, well, I mean, one of the joys of doing this film is being able to dip into the archive. And I had no idea whether Louis Armstrong had ever performed that song before. So I might actually go for the same one, seeing him play that on the TV. It's not technically a perfect rendition of it, if we're being honest. He's in failing health. The balance is terrible. They've got his mic on low, but there's a real poignancy to it and his introduction to it. I was so happy when we found that footage. Then the question was clearing it, and then that's always an issue, and it turned out we couldn't clear it. And then luckily Eon stepped in and asked on our behalf, and I was really happy we got to include it in the film. So I would say the Louis Armstrong performance, even though it's technically imperfect, it's got so much poignancy and emotion to it.
No, I agree. It's having a real renaissance, that song as well. Obviously, it concludes No Time to Die. Spoiler, you know, it ends the film rather beautifully, and tonally it's matching how it was used before in 1969. But it's kind of, I mean, John Grant did a really beautiful, almost pared down version of the Albert Hall for the Sound of 007 concert, which happened recently, which has become a marvellous sort of counterpoint to the documentary. And now I'm so glad both exist out on Amazon Prime, and you've got to kind of watch them both together. I know a lot of people have done them both, like one after the other, and it's made an amazing evening of Bond. And the only problem with your documentary, it's so good that you can never see it again for the first time. It's one of those films. I mean, I love
that's
it.
Really,
yeah,
that's so nice of you to say. I know, I you know, it's, it was a real challenge trying to squeeze 60 years into 90 minutes. And inevitably, I'm sure we've missed crucial stuff out. I think people can be happy in the knowledge, hopefully, that in the 3.5 hour original cut, everything was in there as much as we could possibly squeeze in. But it's just, yeah, we had a 90 minute brief. So that was the plan from the beginning.
And so you've got a little bit of history with sort of the Bond and music world already. You're a very known music documentarian, and you've done sort of leading defining works on various people, notably Oasis in recent times. You've directed videos for Coldplay, I believe, Scott Walker, who did his own Bond song, by the way, and Coldplay have done
yes.
Coldplay did you only twice, I believe, at a concert recently.
Yeah.
But you also directed the Fleming, the Man Who Would Be Bond series that Sky had on a couple of years ago, which I felt I was the only person that really loved it. I knew it was never going to be, you know, it was going to be a little bit of a quasi Bond film. But why do you think Eon came to you to this? Do you think it was, I presume it was more about your music documentary skills than your Ian Fleming dramatic skills? Not that they weren't skillful.
Thank you. Well, I loved working on Fleming. It was a very random one for me because I was supposed to be making a film about the miners' strike, TV series about the miners' strike, but a kind of drama, a kind of thriller about the miners' strike called GB84. And at the last minute, suddenly we didn't have the money. We couldn't get the money for it. And then I just rang my agent. I was like, look, I need to start something else. I don't know what it is. We've been working on this thing for 6 years. And so she introduced me to the company that were making that. And it was a real pleasure. I mean, being a Bond fan, you obviously the dream is always that someone's going to pick up the phone and ring you asking you to do a Bond film. But I always thought that was going to be a bit of a stretch. But this was probably the closest I was ever going to get to it. So it was great. We got to tell, we kind of told it. It was like an origin story for Bond in the sense that you see Ian Fleming go through lots of situations that later happen in the films or inspire the books and the films. I knew John Batsick, the producer. He's a very well known, very acclaimed documentary producer. He did everything from One Day in September to Touching the Void to Searching for Sugarman. And he, we'd been looking for something to do for a while, and he pitched me a few different projects, and for different reasons they hadn't happened. But one day he just, and we've ended up doing a Paralympics documentary in the meantime. But he just said, look, would you be interested in meeting Barbara and Michael at Eon? And I said, yeah, of course. But like, what's the project? He said, well, we don't really know, but we know that we have this anniversary approaching for 60th. They want to do something. They know at that point, I think it was that Danny Boyle had just left the project and Carey had just come on board. So they were in the middle of a million other things, but they still had the presence of mind to think, well, in a couple of years time, we're going to need something else. They knew they weren't going to have a film ready. And this was all pre-COVID. So then obviously no one even knew that the film was going to be delayed. So we went in to go and meet them. And it was a very general, very nice meeting. You know, I just loved the idea of just going into a room and meeting these people who are so iconic and everyone knows so much about. And they were very sweet and very down to earth. Barbara was hilarious. John had just, his wife had just had a baby. And it was me, so before she walked into the room, it was me and I think their development person who just had young kids and then John all talking as men about how hard it is to have young kids. And she came in and started laughing and said, am I really hearing three men talk about how hard it is to have children? So put us in our place. And she was great. And she was immediately like, we know we have this anniversary. What are we going to do with it? You know, well, let's come up with some ideas. And we had some thoughts. One of the ideas had been, you know, just to celebrate Daniel Craig's tenure. And I think in the end, what must have happened, because we didn't hear back for a year. I mean, obviously they were busy making their film, No Time to Die. So I think what happened was Daniel probably thought it was better for his friend to make that film. So that was just one of the ideas that we threw out there. And then about a year later, which you know, that film came out, the Being James Bond film came out, I think a week before No Time to Die, as a kind of celebration of his whole time as Bond. And then John gets a call about a year later from Barbara just saying, okay, well, look, what's happening with this film? So I assumed it had gone away, but someone else was doing it. But anyway, they had finally emerged from, you know, the whatever nightmare scenario is making a Bond film must be like a year of probably the most fun and the most hell you'll ever go through. And they came out and they were just, what are we doing? And the idea that stuck was this music idea, which I think it was Barbara and Michael who had first had the idea anyway. So we just started talking about it and I think we went, oh no, this was still COVID time. So, I mean, not that that's gone away, but it was, I think, in the middle of the second lockdown. So we just had to get on a Zoom call and pitch it to different companies to try and raise the money. And that was it. And it happened very quickly. You know, I think with James Bond and with Barbara and Michael, things just tend to happen overnight. It normally tends to, you know, I've been working on a couple of projects for over 10 years now. But with them, they pitched the idea and the next morning you're doing it. So it was great. So we hit the ground running.
It's called clout.
And it's called clout.
Yeah, yeah.
It's called,
and,
yeah. It's not,
and a 60-year track record as well. Like, what have you produced? I'll show you these. Yeah. So was it, I mean, what was it like when you first got access to the Eon archives? I imagine it was so manifold, but what maybe was the one thing that really just froze you, and you, whether it's in the doc or not, but what was that one clip or that one, you know, what was the holy grail that you find that you were able to use or to discover?
I think the main thing for me was just dipping in. It wasn't one clip, but it was really the John Barry archive as a whole. They had all these great interviews with him, not all of which they owned, but just that they had access to them. Because that was my main reservation going in, is obviously, you know, the man who created the sound of James Bond is John Barry, primarily. And he was, and sadly he passed and passed away. So I was thinking, well, how can we sustain that? How can we tell his story? Often with music documentaries, you have a bit of an issue in that the archive that remains often has music underneath it or on top of it, you know, so it's very hard. And maybe it's been cut a way that you don't want. You really need the rushes. You can't work just by cherry picking bits from other films. And luckily they had a lot of that. So that was when I kind of breathed a sigh of relief, thinking, okay, well, fine, we'll be all right. Same thing with Monty Norman. I suppose we found that we had these tapes, but we knew he was still alive. I mean, I had assumed, because of so many people from that era had passed away, I didn't realize that Monty Norman was still alive. So we were introduced to him and his wife, Rena, and went and interviewed him a couple of times and spoke to Laurie Barry, and then just went through all the Eon contacts and started calling people. But in terms of the archive, it didn't arrive for a couple of months, I think, because they were off busy touring the world with No Time to Die. So it took a little bit of time for us to get up and running, but luckily there was plenty to do. There's plenty of research to do, and there were a lot of people to interview. So, you know, I just said, look, obviously from a filmmaker's perspective, a kind of greedy director's perspective, I want to speak to everyone and I want to cover everything. And then as we get into the edit, well, let's see who we prioritize and what works. But they were great. You know, it's not the easiest thing in the world. A lot of these interviewees are getting up there. They're very busy. They're worried about COVID, understandably. So we had a few, you know, some things were cancelled last minute. And, you know, on a documentary, we had a healthy budget for a documentary, but it still disappears pretty quickly once you factor in the idea you have to, you know, pay for trips and you have to pay for all the music. So that was the main obstacle, really, was just trying to see who was around. But I think very quickly we went in and interviewed Monty, and we started interviewing anyone who was in the UK, and then we flew over the States and did a few other people. So we hit the ground running pretty quickly.
One of the things I really picked up on, especially on that sort of intimate footage of Billie Eilish and Phineas and Hans Zimmer in the wings, and she's doing a different version, and she wants it to have no feedback, so she can just hear it and do her own vocals. And it suddenly dawned on me, you know, I'm a writer. That's kind of my first and foremost function in life. And you can be very precious about stuff. And I felt there was a real intimacy. I felt like I shouldn't have been watching Billie Eilish, just sort of going through those notes, going through that breathing. It was so intimate. Also, the song is so intimate and quiet as well. And then because it's so intimate, people have great sort of passion. And I was wondering if this is a very delicate question that you have to answer even more delicately, but was there a lot of people you had to navigate and emotions you had to navigate? Because some of these, you know, this was a body of work that a lot of people did 40, 50 years ago. So was it hard to try and navigate different people's, I don't want to say egos, because that's not what I mean, but yeah, was it hard to maybe get everyone together on the same hymn sheet? Excuse the music allergy there.
Yeah, well, I thought it might be. I mean, you go into every project not really knowing what it's going to be like. So the things I've done in the past, you know, it's been a mixture of music and politics. We also did a boxing documentary a couple of years ago. We were in the middle of doing that Paralympics one. So, yeah, you never quite know what the parameters are. I mean, that very first meeting with Barbara and Michael, I think it was Michael saying, look, we don't want a puff piece. That's why we've asked you and your team to do it. We don't, you know, obviously they have a great team who film a lot of stuff, who edit things together. They could do it in-house if they just wanted to do kind of an off-the-shelf thing. If they wanted to bring in a team with some perspective, I guess, you know, kind of outsider perspective. So they were great like that. There was nothing, they didn't say anything was out of bounds. In the interviews, when we were talking to people, just as I would in any interview, when we broach subjects that might be more difficult, for example, you know, whether it's, you know, John Barry's tricky relationship with Duran Duran and Aha, or whether it was the Radiohead thing because that didn't work out and that could be sensitive, or whether it was Amy Winehouse, all I could say was that, look, you know, let's talk about it if you're willing, and mm-hmm. if you and then you got to trust me that I put it in the film in a sensitive way. But ultimately, I kind of threw it back to them and was like, look, if you watch our rough cut of the film, if you feel that I'm handling it insensitively, then let's have a discussion. And luckily, they didn't. You know, they spoke about, in the case of Amy Winehouse, for example, you know, I think they spoke about her very movingly and very very sensitively. So that those are the kind of obstacles that I anticipated, but that never really came up. Mm. And similarly, you know, it's with Bond, you know, and other documentaries, you're telling people stories in their lives, but ultimately, it's not a big business. Whereas Bond is something where they have to kind of protect it. It's a family business. They're protecting him and the brand and all those kind of things. Mm. They have to be sensitive about that. There's a reason it's been going for 60 years. But I think partly maybe it survived because they haven't protected it in the way that you might expect. You know, they do take risks. And so, for example, taking, you know, seems obvious that Daniel Craig is one of the best Bonds now, with benefit of hindsight, but at the time that was considered very risky. Mm. It's, mm-hmm. you know, we started talking about the ending of No Time to Die. That's obviously a huge risk, but I think for the bulk of the audience, it paid off. And so with us, again, it was like, we tried things out and I thought maybe they'll say we've gone too far or it's not quite what they anticipated. And what was really nice was the very first time they came into the edit just to watch a few assembled scenes. We showed them a bit of the beginning of the film where we talk about, you know, how the Bond theme came into being, and then we showed them another bit, which I think was the Michael Caine Goldfinger anecdote, and they really liked that. And then at the end, something I'd literally cobbled together the night before was really what's become the ending of the film, which was Hans Zimmer and Steve Mazzara talking about how they harnessed all of John Barry's themes and his style, but then brought their own flavour to it to say goodbye to Bond at the end of No Time to Die. And I put that together. I thought, God, they're going to just think this is kind of a masterclass. This isn't really what we signed up for. And then Michael was very, very sweet. He was just like, that's the best thing you've done. Do more of that. We love that. That's different. That's not what people would be expecting. So they were great. They liked to push the boat out a bit.
Yeah, there's great humour to it, which I was surprised by. I mean, can you do a sequel that is just basically Phineas mocking Hans Zimmer whilst Hans Zimmer sat next to him? Because Phineas's impression of Hans Zimmer, my husband, I've just, you know, lost his stuff alongside. We just found that hilarious. Maybe I shouldn't have done, but sorry, Hans. But it was a lovely moment. And even the humour of Duran Duran, and they were remembering anecdotes of working with John Barry, who had, you know, he admitted he had a very different way of doing things. They were the young whippersnapper pop act of the day. But yeah, I was surprised by the film's humour as well. It had a great, it was quite ballsy, which you want.
Oh, good.
Yeah, you want that from a...
Thank you.
I mean, it wasn't a total fluff piece, nor would it have been, but it had a real edge to it, which I think that's what's endeared it to a lot of fans, because we all see a lot of Bond products and Bond documentaries in hindsight, but this was quite a fresh, ballsy thing. Even having like Natasha Lal, the sitar stuff, I thought that was beautiful, and I could see where it's going, and I knew why it was in there, but I was like, I could just watch an hour of this and hearing that beautiful sound. So you've directed this. You've directed drama before. You did Sex and Drugs and Rock and Roll, which kind of, I think, introduced the world to Naomi Harris. So you were partly responsible for for helping the new Moneypenny come on the scene. But what if Eon, you know, was so impressed by the sound of 007 that they said, you know what, this guy could come and do a Bond film. If you were going to get the Bond film gig, and this is a big if, because they'll come to me first and I'll say yes. But if I have to say no, who would be your ideal Bond title song performer or performers?
What a great question.
Who haven't done it already.
Yeah. Yes. Well, I mean, as far as the Bond songs, it's, you know, what I love about them is that they're so complicated and rich because there's so many things that they have to kind of fulfill. So often they react... The best ones certainly react to the themes and the new star who's playing Bond. So the themes of the film. So it's tricky without having a script. Having said that, what I love is that through the eras, Bond songs and the music of Bond evolves. You know, that's unique to any film franchise, I think. You know, even if you think about other great series from Alien to Harry Potter to, you know, Indiana Jones.
Yeah, who doesn't
You'll never
remember,
get a techno yeah. Indiana Jones.
Who doesn't remember the song from Aliens? It should have charted more than it did. Yeah.
But you know what I mean? They have themes in common with scores anyway. Mm, but you know, mm. that they don't evolve in the same way. And I think that's what I love. But okay, so if you put me on the spot, who I think is interesting out there, it'd be great if it evolved in some way. We talked to Celeste about writing us a song. I'd really like yeah. her. So she's a kind of, for me, she's a Shirley Bassey for the 21st century. So, mm. and I love her. But then if you were going to try and mix things up a bit, you know, if they go for a new Bond who's younger and kind of needs to reflect what it's like to be 25 right now, and maybe it's going to be a gay Bond or maybe a black Bond or a whatever, mm. then maybe it should be different, and maybe it should be a Stormzy or a Little Sims
mm-hmm.
or a collaboration. But, you know, who knows? It's so difficult to tell, because I think if any of us had been smart enough to put money on Billie Eilish a few years ago, we would have probably been laughed out of the bookies, because she didn't even exist as a performer until a couple of years ago.
Yeah, she was 2 years old or something like that when Daniel Craig first did Casino Royale. It's like, so people say, who's going to do the next Bond song? Well, they might not be singing yet. Well, hopefully they will. Hopefully it won't be as long a time as that. So you're talking about, there's so much stuff. Do you think, and you've been asked this a lot, do you feel there's an extended cut there, or perhaps, you know, a later release? Did I hear that you ideally would love to have done like a 2 or 3 part piece on it? Do you feel that, I mean, is there more stuff? Of course there is. There's more edits, more films you're looking at. But do you think we'll ever get to be able to see any of it down the line?
That's a good question. We never actually really discussed it, to be honest, because the brief at the beginning was 90 minutes, or quite soon down the quite early on down the line. It was like, no, we want to do something, A, that it's going to be a standalone feature, because we want something that's going to be punchy, that's going to be impactful, that can just, you sit down and you watch it in one go. Mm-hmm. And so that's what we were always aiming for. So it's not like the 3.5 hour cut was like some masterpiece that the world is missing out on. It was pretty baggy and messy.
Mm.
It would have to, so we'd have to sit down and kind of make it better. Mm. Having said that, we lost a lot of stuff that I loved, you know, inevitably. There was a lot more Casino Royale where David was talking about how, what he brought to it. But maybe people might consider this too much Daniel Craig and too much Casino Royale as it is. There was this funny sequences where, some interesting sequences where I thought where we talked about Naomi Harris and Anna Smith, the film critic Anna Smith, talked a bit about, you know, the way that, so the music's evolved through the years and the films have evolved through the years. If you look at some of the treatment of women, for example, in Thunderball, it's pretty questionable now. But actually what they both said, which I thought was really fascinating, was that the music is so good that it kind of makes it palatable, which is really odd. So the music is telling you that this is okay because it kind of acts as a moral compass. So there was a section on the early films talking about sexual politics and how the music in a way kind of makes it feel okay. But obviously from a 21st century perspective, it's not okay. So that was really interesting, but it just no time. We had a section, let's have a think about it. I mean, obviously we had most of the people's favorite songs were in there. We had a whole section on all the opening visuals, which I really liked and spent a long time on. And we spent ages talking to Daniel Kleiman, and they sent us all over the making of those incredible iconic visuals. So that was a whole section of the film. But again, there was just no time. And we had a very funny, I thought, section on Aha and John Barry falling out. But we'd kind of done it with the Duran bit. Mm. And so I think, yeah, we got notes back just saying, is this not like a double beat? Do we need both songs? If something's got to give, which it does, then we're going to have to lose it. But it's a shame because obviously the opening visuals bit, we spoke a lot to Sheena Easton, and we had a whole sequence on how For Your Eyes Only, kind of in a sense, can be argued invented MTV before MTV, or just as MTV was starting. Mm. And Maurice Binder kind of did that through his work, created the visual style that's been aped ever since. And Daniel Kleiman talked about that legacy and about how GoldenEye led to them because those opening titles are so great, but they bring that political side of kind of the end of communism, at the end of the USSR. So that then when they went back, Barbara was on the opening of Tomorrow Never Dies. It's Tomorrow Never Dies? No, on the opening of The World Is Not Enough, which is the one where World Is Not Enough is when he, no, it's the Madonna one, isn't it? It's where he's tortured at the beginning.
That's Die Another Day, yeah.
Yeah, Die Another Day. So then they had problems filming that film because of the opening titles in GoldenEye. No, maybe it was Tomorrow Never Dies, actually. Mm-hmm. But anyway, in whichever case, they basically and it ends up causing problems further down the line. So all this stuff was great, and I struggled to cut it out personally. I'm very, that's why I have to work with a great edit team, because I'm very indulgent and I'd happily sit through a 7-hour cut of any of these films.
I would,
But
yeah.
then reality has to intrude, and so we have versions of it. I don't know. We haven't really discussed it, to be honest. I mean, similar thing for the Oasis one and the Coldplay films. We had 6 and 7 hour cuts of those films, and then gradually you just have to bring it down.
Right. Did you ever hear any Bond track or song or even a half of a demo that no one else knows existed? And if you have, obviously you better not say who it was by. But did you ever hear something went, oh, if only we could put this in, but it's just going to be too complicated or too much of a curveball?
No, there was nothing where it was like we were told we weren't allowed to. There were a couple of people who were in line for Bond films, which no one knows about. Which again, Barbara Michael said, "Look, it's fine for you to discuss this in the film, but we didn't because we haven't put it in the film. I probably shouldn't say." But
No,
very, very big stars. We had, I mean, some of the things I loved personally. Obviously, Matt Monro is not known by young people now, I would imagine, unless you're like a complete aficionado of the '60s. But he's, From Russia with Love is one of my favorites, and his voice is one of my favorites. We had the original tapes of him recording that in Abbey Road. And, he has one of the best voices in history, but he was also like a 3-pack of cigarettes a day kind of guy, at least to down a bottle of whiskey in the evening. So it's really funny because you
Who
can hear
doesn't? Yeah.
him. Yeah, exactly. Who didn't back in those
Yeah.
days? And so you can hear him on the mic, and he'd be there singing so beautifully. And halfway through him going, coughing his
Ooh.
lungs up, and like, oh, I'm gonna need another one, John. I mean, I loved all that stuff. And we interviewed, there was other people we interviewed Steve Coogan, who is brilliant on John Barry. But as we
Yeah.
cut John Barry down, we ended up having to cut a lot of that. And we ended up ha we interviewed quite a few journalists as well. And I think that the note we got back from everyone from Eon and so on was just like, we'd rather hear more from musicians rather than people talking about what they thought was going on. Let's talk about, let's have it from the horse's mouth. The only issue really was that, a lot of musicians don't know the history necessarily. So you need, that's why we had John Burlingame and a couple other people, like, Jason Solomons and so on coming in and just give you a bit of the history. Otherwise, Hans Zimmer loves John Barry's music, but he doesn't know, who was doing what back in the '60s or the '70s. He doesn't have that kind of attention to details.
So did you, so just to maybe conclude a bit, so accompanying the documentary was the sound of 007 in concert, which happened at the Albert Hall last week. At what point did you cry or pretend that the room was a bit smoky? Because I did about 3.5 times.
I was just blown away. I mean, it's funny because obviously that music is so important to all of us, I think, growing up. And just Shirley Bassey walking out and being in the same room as her and her getting a standing ovation before she'd even opened her mouth. I think that was literally the first thing that happened. I think I was a bit wobbly there. And then probably the most emotional moment, I think, was David Arnold's tribute to Chris Cornell, when he sang Chris's theme for Casino Royale. And he's amazing. I've never heard him sing it before. So that was incredible. And then I suppose also, yeah, even if it was, maybe just Don Black coming out and talking about John Barry, that was great. And then that, the music, the scores are so good. It's so lovely to hear them performed live by the Royal Philharmonic. I mean, it doesn't get any better than that.
No,
What about
I actually got a bit
you?
emotional at Lulu, and that was because it's not an emotional song, but it was just, oh my God, she's here, she's doing that song. Because I've been fortunate to see Shirley Bassey do those two songs in the past, and whilst it's still an utter privilege, I've never seen Lulu do it like that. I mean, she just gave it so much camp and bombast, and she sold it well. So I was literally like, oh God, I'm crying at the wrong song here. So
She's amazing.
yeah.
So that was one of the highlights for me, was meeting her and getting to interview her. She's a full absolute force of nature. And when she found out, she was pretty down on her song. It was funny because I was sitting there as a kind of cheerleader saying, "You're great, that I love that. I love that film and I love that song." And oh, have we cut off? You still
No,
there?
we're good. I'm here.
Yeah, and yeah, I love that film and I love that song, but it's not often singled out as one of the best. And John Barry said he'd kind of dropped the ball, and Lulu was like, "Well, I was just in the shadow of Shirley Bassey. I didn't really, I'm never going to be Shirley Bassey." But I told her that my kids love that song, and she absolutely beamed. She like got them on the phone, sang it down the line to them, recorded a video. She was so sweet. So Yeah, that was one of the highlights
Oh,
for me.
I love it. Obviously, it's like a dirty grenade of a song there. It just like tick ticks and then blows up. It blows up. Matt, I don't want to keep you much longer, but I was thinking recently a Bond song goes round the world quicker than a Bond film. And I think it oddly means more to people than a Bond film, if that makes sense. The next Bond is going to be a big discussion point, but I think throughout the world, I remember being stood when Skyfall came out. I was at a bus stop and I could hear two elderly ladies talking about the film, and then behind me was some scaffolders whistling the tune. And I thought these songs kind of almost get under people's skins more than the films themselves. And what I want to say is I think your documentary will do that also. And I feel that you've created a really clever, special, warm work. It's very contemporary as well. So again, I'm just going to congratulate you to the hilt on this. And no, seriously, well done on The Sound of
Thank you.
007. You've done a good job there. You've done a good job. But I want to see two or three more sequels, okay? So no pressure. All right.
Sounds good. All right, it's a deal.
But
Well,
thank you.
thank you very much.
No worries.
It's so sweet that you enjoyed it. I really appreciate it.
No, and thank you for your time. Thank you.
Thank you.